But it's a beautiful song, and I just wanted to talk a little bit about that because I think it does end on an uplifting note. Like, yes, darkness happens, bad things can happen, but you can take something beautiful out of it, and life does continue.
My personal part of this record is definitely grief. It's definitely the process of grief. It's against a backdrop of national grieving. White Heat deals with my reaction to feelings of utter uselessness in the wake of what happened in the Manchester Arena and what happened at Grenfell. And weirdly, I was straddling both cities freshly. It was just after my son was born. And the questions that it throws up and wondering how complicit you are by being white and privileged. And, you know, and that goes over to Brexit as well. I am probably not surprisingly, I voted Remain. And I expected us to romp home, which tells me that my acquired privilege has blinkered me to 50% of the country who aren't happy. I'm not having it that they're racist or stupid or both. I know some of them are, usually the most vocal ones. But I'm not having this entrenched thing where they are very bad people. You just can't do that. Mm-hmm. And it's the thing about this is 50% of the country thinks the other half are very bad people. And you can feed yourself arguments from all over the place, from actors and musicians and politicians that you admire, feeding your argument. Of course you're going to feel like you have all the answers. But the fact of the matter is that half of us are willing to gamble everything on change. And human beings don't fucking like change. You know, they resist it. And if half of us are willing to gamble everything on any kind of change, that tells me I'm blinkered to the state of the nation and that I need to talk to people and I need to listen to people. And so none of that is on the record. All that's on there is my initial bewildered feelings of horror that you can burn to death for being poor in the richest borough in this country, and that a son of Manchester can be so lost to everybody that he can take the lives of children. So that's in there. No answers.
Yeah.
Lots of questions. But by the time you get to White Heat, on my personal grief timeline, God, you can't fucking wait to hear this. You must be drooling. The song ends with Bring Me Sunshine. the last song, Weightless, was about, as I was talking before, about how easy it was to love my dad at the end. And it's a song written to my son about my dad. And, of course, you know, my son being born made my father dying a part of something, not the end of something. And, you know, it's not the only way to acknowledge death as a part of life. You know, my friends that I've lost, I get to grieve with some of the best friends a man ever had. And we get to celebrate those people forever, you know, and shout about them and talk about them. And that's affirmation of life being wonderful and fleeting and beautiful. And hopefully that last song says all of this horror is the stuff that beauty is in high relief against.
That's beautifully said. Well, on a lighter note, as it's national...
How could it possibly be a lighter?
As it's National Album Day, which albums were you listening to in the last couple of years when you were recording and writing this album?
Because of my radio program, I listen to all music all the time. I'm fed new music, and I'm also fed music I might not have heard by the listeners. So I'm constantly picking things up, swirling around. I'm not somebody who insists on bulletproof excellence in music. I can enjoy something for an element of it. And in those ways, I think I'm still learning. So what I was listening to is too vast a question. What all of us agreed on, in terms of what all Elbow agreed on, I'd say the one record that really made a big dent while we were in Hamburg together particularly was the Alt-J record, Relaxer. and it's a fantastic record. And he's so brave lyrically, and it's so brave musically. And you know that they're writing about where they're from with without shame, which involves writing shamefully. We went to see them in Hamburg. They were playing a festival while we were there, just by chance, and we shuffled into a festival together. As people in the crowd, which, I mean, we just haven't done that together ever, I don't think. And because we're not particularly well-known out there, we could shuffle around. And we were by far the oldest people there. Yeah. And we probably looked really dodgy. And but we were seeing what happens, you know. And we watched them play, and it was electrifying. It was so good. And you know, I mean, I know one of the members of the band quite well, and you know, just from experience, you can tell where somebody is in a circuit, where they are on a tour, how they might be feeling about a crowd response, or all those things. And they were casually delivering this remarkable, intricate, brilliant, exciting music, and you can hear that they're a gang as well. And right at the root of being an elbow is that we've formed as a gang. You know, it was like, I didn't know what kind of music I wanted to make, I just wanted to be part of something. And so did the others, I think. And we still really enjoy that element of it.
Fantastic. Now, this is a more difficult question. What are your top five albums of all time? Difficult.
Now that's what I call music. See what I did there? Laughingstock by Talk Talk is my number one. And Spirit of Eden is number two.
Yes, fantastic.
And this is because Spirit, the experimentation, you know, his insistence or their insistence on grabbing the breaths off notes, the first expressions, and working with the new technology of moving things around is such a beautiful way. But Laughingstock trumps it for me in a nerdy way, like albums can trump one another. Because they wrote those songs with that palette. So having invented a whole palette of colours that nobody's ever heard before, they were then brave enough to go and write another bunch of tunes with it. And it just absolutely sings to me, all of it, always.
And it really revolutionized rock music too. I think, you know, bands like Radiohead and yourselves really sprang out of that, are the legacy of Talk Talk, really.
Definitely. Yeah. And it's about, you know, I mean, you can argue technically that it went back to the Beach Boys and the Beatles, but spiritually, it's a different thing. And I'm going to really badly misquote Benjamin Britten. In fact, it might not even be him. But there was something about the best that music... It was Benjamin Britten. The best that music can be is to... oh, fuck, I've really fun. Is to be really good. is to mimic religion or something like that, to mimic spirituality. So this is a guy who wrote a load of hymns as well. It's like he had no faith, but then he made his music to be as spiritual as possible. And it's like, who knows why music touches us.
Okay, you gave us two records. You have three more to go.
Oh, shit.
I'm not letting
you
off the hook.
Bjork's Vespertine. Which is just amazing. Mm-hmm. Choirs to harps to words. Writing English in a... writing lyrics in a second language means she arrives at poetry that somebody who was born here and studied it their whole lives would never arrive at. And there's just such amazing frailty, femininity, strength and experimentation. And yeah, just a masterpiece. In terms of songwriting from the heart, Joni Mitchell's For the Roses,
oh, yeah.
Which is like being walked through a heartbreak, you know. And I love that she was up in the hills doing it as well, because all those feelings that you have for a partner who's not as interested as you want them to be, you know, she tries to turn him on, she ends up shouting at him, you know, she swears at him, she pulls him apart, like, real character assassination. And then she soberly just says she wants to see him now and again, yeah. You know, and you can hear every element. It was all laid bare, and she knew that wasn't a good look in terms of quite how much she beat him up and how desperate she sounds, but she gave it to us all. And I think it's amazing for that.
She's amazing. I'm just working my way through her discography. You know, I'm at Mingus now because I get obsessed with each album. I got very obsessed with it. And this summer, I was really obsessed with Court and Spark and The Hissing of Summer Lawns. Like every morning I'd listen to one or the other. She's just, I picked her in the classic albums by women back. I had to wait for other people. She got the most albums, actually, followed by Bjork and Nina Simone, actually. Okay, sorry. Fifth album.
Fifth album. So we've got to go, what did you say? Huh? It's really, really good. Any other suggestions? Huh? It's very, very good. John's, yeah. I can't go full on yes. Neil Young's there. He reminds me of a guy I played Conkers with at school. Too much to be included in my top five. I'm going to have to go Natural History by Ian Clute, which I produced. But I have to say, in fact, no, I can do another Ian Clute album that I didn't produce. Right. I played something on my program today from Gods and Monsters. John Bramwell is a genius. He's probably the best lyricist of this generation. He's also he also knows it. But in I Am Clute, you had this amazing sort of torch song, Jack Burrell, burlesque sort of bass work from my very good friend Peter, and then you had this Keith Moon figure on the drums. And if John had done this on his own from the start, he would have been pigeoned with Safe Folk. He would undoubtedly have named it after himself. And what he ended up with instead was this crazy mix of everything that's beautiful about Paris in the 30s, everything that's terrifying about punk, rightly so, and just the most amazing fractured imagery, which actually, you know, it'll never be done again. And I'm very, very proud to have had been anything to do with him.
Oh, that's fantastic. Great. Now, you hosted a documentary for Radio 4, BBC Radio 4, called The Art of Sequencing, which I'm very proud to say that I and Classic Album Sundays was on. So, but it's all about how you order the tracks on an album and how it can take you on a journey. Did you spend a lot of time sequencing this album in terms of the order and where you wanted it to go to take people on a journey? And what kind of journey were you trying to take people on?
The album is the finished product for Elbow. It was never a conversation that we had. We've just always known it. Some artists, the finished art is the song. The album is a recording. It's one rendition of that song, one performance of that song. That's the one that went on the album, you know. For us, the whole art form is the recording and the finished thing. There were 12 songs on this album 3 days before it was mastered. Oh, wow. And there was only 9 when we finally mastered it, because the balance was upset, and it was only in the dragging together of it and the finishing of things. And I've always said that you have a hatchet in one hand and a fine brush in the other in the last stages of a record, and you're editing whole chapters of your recent life, you know. And my dad's voice was going to be on the record till the last minute, and the boys were really cool with it and even encouraging and supportive of it. And right at the last moment, I said, that makes this about me and not us. And I think we need to scale it back. There's 2 songs that very nearly made it about Dad, about being in Vancouver when Dad was dying, which just took it off the precipice of sad. You know, we've written, what we have here now is an album that we're all 100% proud of. And it's a track shorter than any album we've put out before, but we stand by every beat, second, and note, word, etc. So sequencing-wise, Mark and I arrived at the same sequence on our own, with the exception of one tune, which was in a different place. And on the day of mastering, we'd been arguing our points with each other really, really tactfully for weeks. And Ali, our guy from the record label, who's a wonderful man who's helped us put all this together, including this tonight. Ali was down with the band for the first time and it was a frosty atmosphere. And at one point he made a suggestion and I don't think anyone looked at him. or I don't think anyone looked at you or spoke to you, did they, Ali? So, really sorry. No, and you know, had it been a month earlier, it probably would have not fallen on really angry deaf ears. But it was so tense. I knew my way was right. He knew his way was right. And the other thing is, if the more you're established, the longer you go on, the more entrenched in your opinions you become. So when you do disagree, it's proper. So there was this sort of very obviously too subtle for Ali to notice this going on. And I don't think Mark would mind me telling you, but he tried to trip me up with an argument I'd made the day before. And I very haughtily said something like, well, if you're going to try and trip me up with an argument I've made, as if in cross-examination, well, that's not just not only helpful, not unhelpful, it's not adult. And then I stropped out the room. And then I turned on my heel, came straight back in and I went, telling you you're not adult and then storming out the room is not very adult. And we ended up listening to them both and decided on one of them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So who won?
Not telling you.
I knew you were good. Oh, okay. No, you might be too close to it now. It might be difficult to say, but where do you think at the moment that this album sits in the Elbow canon of albums?
It's too early to say. Because they're all diary entries. They're all what was going on with us individually. And they're memories of touring and they're memories of things that happened to us once the album is released, you know. At the moment, apart from in a few minutes' time, it's a really beautiful secret that we've got between us, you know, the people who've made it and helped put it together. And it's so exciting. And if I'm not up with the boy in the morning, I put it on and I get drunk and I text the lads and they all do the same thing. And, you know, and that's, you know, that sounds like terribly, you can't be that good friends after 28 years. But we are, you know. And so at the moment, it's just something, from the few reviews that have landed, it's connected in the way we wanted it to. And for now, that's good enough. We're immensely proud of it. I think it's the best album sleeve, actually, that we've ever had.
I did want to ask about that. Can we talk about the album sleeve? It's a Getty image I saw in the back because I always wanted to read about it. Can you tell us a bit about this image?
So have you all seen it?
Yeah, you can see it.
So these pools in China, they're just holidaying things. They're just enormous outdoor salinated wave pools. And we knew we wanted a picture of a crowd on the front because of the feelings of division that I was talking about earlier and stuff. We're just like, people are fucking great. Let's have people on the cover. Also, we wanted something. We were always told to pick an image that would work as a thumbnail because that's how most people see album sleeves these days. And this time we thought, like, this is an immensely personal one. Let's make one that works best like that. And it was my idea to, whoops, to when you open it up, there's an even bigger one. But these wave pools are, in case the more hygiene conscious of you were worried about it, heavily salinated. When the waves come, it's amazing. You see everybody's face light up at the same time. But the initial feeling of panic you see when you see it, like, oh my God, are they all okay? They're there by choice and they're having a wonderful time. And if you look at the sleeve close up, you can see all of life going on in that part of the world. The biggest of these pools holds 230,000 people. Yeah, it's crazy. Oh, and they're holidaying. And and it just, you know, we wanted a crowd and also we're middle-aged and the noise and the colour and the tempo of the 21st century so far has been a bit much. And it just spoke to that as well. It's, I hate that phrase. It spoke to that as well. So this, yeah, Craig found it on the internet. Really annoying when Craig just does everything better.
Well, we're just about to listen to the album on this beautiful hi-fi. Is there anything we should listen out for?
Anything you should listen out for? I'm trying to think. Oh, so, yes, there's a confusing lyric in Doldrums, the one about Vancouver. The place I found in Vancouver that was kind of mine was a bar, not unlike the Night and Day bar in Manchester, where it was a cafe all day and then it turned into a bar at night. And there's an awful lot of carpenters in Canada, and there's laws to do with building buildings out of anything else. And I just felt at home. These were very different people, but all with the same trade, that gathered at this bar. And I got to know the characters quite well, and I kept myself to myself. And, you know, nobody knows who I am in that part of the world, which is great for scribbling and sitting and thinking. And then somebody mentioned that all the buildings in Vancouver have to be earthquake-proof because it's sat on the end of an old fault line, like there's any new ones. It sat on the end of a fault line, and they're kind of underpinning everything is they're due an earthquake, like, and have been for a long time. And I was so not enjoying being there. I have to apologise to Vancouver again. I did give it a total kicking in that song because there's loads of things that are amazing about it. But it's natural beauty for a start. But anyway, I was sat at this bar, this earthquake thing comes up, and I was like, well, were you taught as kids? Like, I remember Duck and Cover and the nuclear bomb and all that. I remember the warning films, the public information films. I was like, was there the equivalent for the earthquake, the impending earthquake? It kind of made some kind of sense of the character of the city for me. And they said, yeah, absolutely. You've got to do this, you've got to do that. I can't remember, standing in a doorway, stuff like that. And I said, what was it called? And they didn't have a name. Like, we had Duck and Cover. Nobody could give me a name for this. So, Are You Quake Awake, which is what the backing vocal sings at the beginning and the end of the song, is my branding for a 41-year-old earthquake awareness film that doesn't exist. And the girl that sings it is a girl called Lara Chilton, who was working as an intern. What did we used to call interns?
Apprentice.
She was working as an apprentice at the studio in Brixton, and she was there for a couple of months. And every time you walked by, she'd pick up the guitar and start singing. And as you went through the door, you'd hear her stop. And she was doing this for all the people streaming in and out of the studio. And then literally, I needed a voice to try this idea out. And Lara came in and did it. And she's got loads of irons in the fire now. But at the time, I had this kind of, want to be in the movies. I could have thought of a better analogy given recent events. I basically, I had these feelings of, I'm giving this person a break. I needed a break once, you know, and she came in and she sang it. But she nailed it so unequivocally. It knocked my socks off. So listen for her beautiful voice. She's not doing anything close to what she's capable of here, but she is street and cool as fuck. And look out for Chilly Chilton.
Fantastic. Thank you. Please put your hands together for Guy Garvey.